My name is Thorsten Kuckuck and I want to present OpenTheCubic, give a short status update what we did in the last year and which exciting new technology we are working on. So I'm a distinguished engineer at SUSE. I'm also senior architect for the SUSE Linux Enterprise Server and macOS, and I'm leading the future technology team. I'm since over 20 years with SUSE and have a history of about 25 years as open source developer. The agenda is I will introduce OpenSUSE macOS, OpenSUSE Cubic, tell a little bit about the container runtime we are using, the workload, about Yomi, something we are currently develop, about Kubernetes, kubeadm, and Cubic control. What is a Cubic project? In May 2017, we founded it as a sub-project of OpenSUSE. And the main focus is on core operating system technologies, especially for big clusters, but also, of course, for container and Kubernetes. The container host OS we use for OpenSUSE Cubic is OpenSUSE macOS. It's what we call the perfect container host. It's predictable, scalable, reliable. It's automatic. Initial configuration, it will be automatically configured during first boot, especially account and network. We use Podman as a default container runtime, and since it is based on OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, it's a rolling release. Rolling release means whenever there is a new version upstream, we package it, put it in Tumbleweed, and you get it immediately. So if for Kubernetes, there will all be all every 3 months a new version. So we don't stay with one version for a year or 2 years or 3 years, like in the enterprise code stream, but immediately, if there is a new Kubernetes version, we package it and provide it as update. And in the same time, remove then the older versions. Another important thing about OpenSUSE Micro is that size matters. Why is size such important? Every package which is on the system installed can become an update in the future. But on the other side, every update is risky, even if we make sure that this risk is as low as possible, there is a risk. Additional, every update also disturbs the workload. It requires bandwidth, and to do a rollback, we cannot immediately delete the old packages, but we have to store the old version and the new version to do, be able to roll back to this version. So if you now think about packages which are rarely used, only there for convenience, maybe needed once or twice a year, it always is a risk to update it. It disturbs your workload in the most cases for nothing. Predictable is something we fulfill with a read-only root file system, and to be able to update it, we introduced atomic updates. Atomic means in this case either the update is fully applied or not at all. So a typical problem like I update in RPM, the post-install section goes wrong, and then I have an undefined system because the old and the new RPM are both installed, but in an undefined state, you don't know what will happen if you use this application in the first feature. Cannot happen. And also important to achieve is an update does not influence the running system. And also important, we can easily roll back it to a known working state that can be done immediately without manual interaction, normally by the admin. We use ButterFS and SnapShots as implementation for the implementation of it. It's very space efficient. We don't have two partitions with the full system between you switch, but only store the difference of the last update on disk. It also has advantage that the full root file system is read-only, not like in most cases that the root file system is read-write and only the user partitions are read-only. And we also included /etc in the snapshot and rollback process. That's important if you think about you are doing a major version update of your software. During this update, the configuration files will be adjusted, And if you now do a rollback and your configuration files are on the read-write-root file system, which is not included in the rollback, then the old application will not work anymore because the new config file is the wrong one, so they don't fit together. And the admin has to interact manually and fix it. That's something which we don't want, especially not in big clusters. We are also very flexible since we use RPMs. So no package for new package format is necessary. You can continue to use your old applications as RPM, install them. You could also use the solid driver program from SUSE, and it's easy and hands-able. During the first boot, normally Cloud Init will be used in the public cloud. We don't want to change that for the public cloud. We still will continue to use Cloud Init. It's the best out there and supported by every cloud vendor. But for bare metal or KVM installations, it's not really the best choice. It's too fat and it's too much aligned for public cloud and not for the requirements of a bare metal configuration. So we decided to use Ignition. It's running out of the RAM disk and allows to do things which you cannot do with Cloud Init, like create an own new var partition and populate it. It can format partitions, it can write files and enable systemd services and configure users, means creating new users, setting passwords, or apply SSH key so that you can log in without the need of a password. That's fully enough for most cases. If you think, for example, network configuration is missing, now in the end, you put the network configuration in the con you take the config file of the network configuration, write it to disk, and that's all you need normally. SUSE Microsystems is reliable in the case that we have a yield checker. So during the first boot, after an update, we check if everything behaves as it should. If something is not behaving correctly, we do immediately a rollback and automatic to the last known working snapshot. And the admin can then analyze the log files or the new snapshot, what goes wrong, why something is not working. We can do as many rollbacks to the same known state as we want. Since the system is read-only root file system, nothing has changed on disk. And booting the old snapshot will bring you always at the same point in the same state, and you can do it as often as you want. If you compare this with SUSE Linux Enterprise Server, the snapshot rollback, if you do a rollback, you need to at first create a new snapshot, and most in the cases, you even need to boot twice until you have done a real rollback. And you can only do it once into a snapshot and not many times. So that's all no issue with OpenSUSE MicroS. Now, a read-only root file system means if you need debugging tools for network, your application, your workload, whatever, you cannot easily install it because with atomic update, you always have to reboot to activate the changes. But if you reboot, your workload or your setup is different, then the situation is different than before. And this makes debugging really hard. We have a toolbox utility and a toolbox container for these reasons. So you can launch a small privileged container. In this container, you can install with Zipper all the tools you need. And if they are not available in the OpenSUSE repositories, you can add all devel or other repositories you want. And the container is persistent between usages as long as you don't delete it. So from this container, with all the tools you want or need to debugging, you can then access the system or the root file system and log files, which are mounted below media root. Now, transactional updates do even have more problems with modified configuration files because you don't see them until you reboot, and you can modify them at the same time as the update in the background is modifying them. So merging with the next boot is next to impossible or pretty hard. So if you think about the typical problems issues reported on the mailing list on Bugzilla, Service XYZ doesn't work anymore after the last update. Typical answer will be, did you check for RPM save in RPM new files? The answer is, oops, okay, now it's working, thanks. So all this manual merging does of course not scale with big clusters, so we need something new. And we also want to have something more robust for our traditional OpenSUSE and enterprise distributions. So OpenSUSE and SUSE will go and use user ETC. The goal is that all distribution delivered default configuration files are stored in user ETC. And slash etc only contains all local host-specific changes the admin made or the installation medium is doing. In the runtime, the application will merge them like the system D is doing it at the first start with user lib system D system and etc system D system. There's an OpenSUSE wiki page which lists all applications we did already modify and what it means for you as user administrator. If you think, why do we do such crazy thing and completely different to everybody else? It's not different and it's not really new. If you take a closer look at your system, you will find out that there are already many applications which store the default distributed configuration file below user lib or user share and have an etc only the override. The problem there is nobody knows where in user lib and user share he has to search for the original configuration file. So we only want to consolidate it in one place for new software. Existing software are already doing this default and override part. We will not touch, at least not as long as upstream will not do it themselves too. OpenSUSE Cubic is our Kubernetes distribution. It's Kubernetes certified. It uses OpenSUSE MicroS as container host OS and it's using Cryo as a container runtime environment. It's a kettle, so all machines should look identical. And then we only start the processes we need or configure the way we need it. OpenSUSE Cubic and contains everything you need to install, run, and maintain a Kubernetes cluster. It's coming with several system roles. The Cubic admin node is the first Kubernetes master with Salt and our Cubic control daemon. If you want to use Cubic control, additional Cubic nodes. If you want to use Cubic control with additional multi-master setups or add additional worker nodes, the load balancer system role is then the HA proxy for multi-master setup. There's also a kubeadm node if you want to deploy Kubernetes at your own with help of kubeadm. And of course, there's still the container host system role if you only want to run containers without Kubernetes. Pets or kettle? If you don't know exactly what kettle mean in the regard of OpenSUSE Cubic, so there's a nice definition or a description of pets and kettles. So in the old way of doing things, we treat our servers like pets. For example, Bob the mail server. If Bob does gone, it's all hands on deck. The CEO can't get his email, and it's the end of the world. In the new way, servers are numbered. Like kettles in the herd, for example, from WWW1 to 100. And if one server goes down, it's taken out, remove it, replace it, and put a new in the line. Common mistakes in using Cubic containers is that people treat a container like a virtual machine. This will reduce most advantages of the container model. In the end, you have all disadvantages of the container model and disadvantages of a virtual machine, and you don't really have a benefit of it. Another mistake is treat your kettles like a pet. That may work with 10 to 30 node beginner clusters, so small ones, but if you have big clusters, you don't have the time anymore to do that. Also, it's a mistake to use Kubernetes as hardware consolidation. If you have the workload for 4.5 nodes, a cluster size of 4, 5 nodes is too small. Why? To reboot a machine or replace a machine. For maintenance, updates, if it is broken, whatever. You need to move the workload on another machine. But you only have 0.5 nodes free, but you have the workload for one node. You cannot move it anywhere. So you cannot boot that machine, you cannot replace it, whatever. So also always make sure that you have enough free resources to free up one machine to replace it or boot it. So as container runtime for a container host OS, we are using Podman. It's a command line interface tool for running OCE containers in pods. And the most important thing about this is Podman, the Podman interface is similar to the Docker interface. In most cases, you can simply replace Docker with Podman and use the old command. As container runtime for Kubernetes, we use Cryo. It's focusing on the special needs of Kubernetes and designed especially for this reason. Has a lot of lightweight, secure, what should I say, techniques like AppArmor, SecComm, cgroups, and so on. The workload, of course, for container host OS and for a Kubernetes cluster are always containers. This has many advantages, like your workload is isolated from the core file system, which means you can update the operating system and the containers independent of each other. And also, it reduces the ability for malicious applications to compromise the system because a container does not have full access to the system. You can also replace workloads easily without the need to reboot the machine as you would need to if you update the OS. Update in an atomic way is also possible. Create the new container, kill the old one. And if the new one doesn't work, kill the new one, restart the old one. For container host, for Kubernetes, you have manifest file which deploys the containers and configure them. If you have a container host OS without Kubernetes, you need to do it at your own. OpenSUSE has meanwhile a lot of application containers which are officially supported. You can go to registry OpenSUSE.org to see them. For some of them, we provide systemd services, which starts with containers and make sure that the environment is correctly configured for them and they are set with the correct one. So we have applications container like Bind, DHCP, HApproxy, MariaDB, and Nginx. But we also have service files and scripts to set up an own container registry with role-based access control. Yomi, or yet one more installer, is the newest exciting project we are working on. It's a new type of installer and it should more or less replace AutoJS just in the far away future, maybe at some point in time. It allows parallel installation of nodes with different hardware configurations, unattended. You can simple YAML file or smart linear two configuration files can be used. And it's easy to orchestrate, that's a single decision point. As it uses solid states, it's independent and it can work alone or it could be integrated into a big solution. So the use cases are mainly installing many machines which are similar but there are small differences. So if you look at AutoJust, you need an own AutoJust profile for all these machines with a slightly different workload. So most of the cases, XML file is identical for AutoJust, but there are small changes on them. And with Yomi, that's much easier, and you can install the hardware identical for everything, but then deploy roles or add roles like control plane, storage, computing for OpenStack and Kubernetes. Or if certain nodes can only be installed and started after other nodes are installed. Yomi is currently a proof of concept for cubic control. So you can, for example, deploy the load balancer with it. So you tell cubic control at the beginning, deploy a multi-master setup. There is a and also install a load balancer based on HApproxy for it. And if the HApproxy, if the machine is installed with OpenSUSE MicroS. HA proxy will be installed. It will give over to the normal Kubernetes deployment routine. And if a new master is added, it's automatically added to the HA proxy. We are also working on integrating it into SUSE Manager as our enterprise product. And that's currently work in progress and should be available in the next SUSE Manager version. Kubernetes is, also OpenSUSE Kubik is a Kubernetes certified distribution, as I already said. And normally it's installed with kubeadm. There is a wiki page which lists all the instructions you need to follow with kubeadm. While kubeadm does configure and start Kubernetes itself, you have to do a lot of manual steps around it, like the CNE network and so on. If you think that is still far too complicated for you, we introduce Kubik Control. It's a client-server tool, so you have a Kubik D as daemon. It's running on the first Kubernetes master together with a salt master, but it can also run on your salt master if you have already somewhere else in the network and the Kubernetes cluster is independent of it, only registered as salt minion. We use gRPC for encrypted communication. Since every user will get its own certificate for this encryption, we can also do role-based access, which user is allowed to do what. As already said, we will use salt for the communication with the cluster, but we will not use salt states to configure Kubernetes. That's still done with kubeadm. And we don't plan to change that. So Kubik run on, as I said, on the salt master, on an existing one, or on the first master node if you don't have a salt master yet. So that's more or less the infrastructure with Kubik control. You have a big cluster with nodes and master and worker. You can have a local registry, that's not a requirement. You can have a load balancer if necessary. You have a machine with the salt master and Kubik D. This all can be a single machine. This could be three different machines. That can run on top of your normal Kubernetes master. It's your choice and depends on your requirements and resources. So deploying a Kubernetes cluster is quite simple with it. Kubik CTL init will set up the first master. If you want to have a multi-master, you need to tell it to it. With Kubik control node, you can add as many nodes as you want at the same time. It can be additional masters or worker nodes. With Kubik CTL upgrade, you will not only update your Kubernetes distribution, but also CNI network and additional pods, services, daemon sets, whatever you installed with Kubik CTL. And you can also deploy it with Yomi. If there are any questions, unfortunately, I cannot answer them here in the recording. But you can go to kubikopensuse.org, our main project webpage, and look there for documentation, how to contact us, where you can reach us, and so on. And I hope I will hear or see you there. Thanks.